And I was stunned as a theoretical physicist because I thought, oh yes, this is something, is a good formalism. You know, every time you reflect something in the formalism, you can then calculate with it. If you have just a good idea about it, you say, yeah, we know all about that, and of course. But if it's not reflected in the formalism, you can't really apply the mathematics to it. And so it's important, or it could be important, depending on what you want to do, to reformulate theories like this. Well, long story short, in the classical domain, this has been developed over decades by, I think it originated with Arjan van der Schaft and Bernard Maschke, and many other people work on this. Now in Germany, there's a big research center on this. So this Port Hamiltonian viewpoint is a very interesting one. It won't solve everything. Maybe it solves nothing, but it gives you a new perspective. Okay, that's what it is. And I started thinking together with collaborators on how this could turn out or play out in quantum mechanics. And in quantum mechanics, we also talk about energy. We have a Hamiltonian. We could make energy measurements. The Hamiltonian is still the generator of the time evolution, as long as you don't measure, right? So for the unitary evolution.
Right.
So could we talk about these energy flows in quantum systems? And the answer is, if you look closely at it, no, that doesn't seem to make much sense, but it's something else that flows there. It's probability that flows in quantum systems between subsystems. And that's the next thorny issue. How do you do with subsystems in quantum mechanics and so on? And we now believe to have cracked at least two of the three most prominent problems. How does this work? What is actually flowing there? How do you actually get this onto the street formally? And also, how do you deal with composed systems? Because quantum systems famously composed by tensor products. So the Hilbert spaces of the Hilbert space of composite system is the tensor product of the Hilbert spaces of the what we think are the constituent systems. But of course, the tensor product contains many states that could never be understood in terms of the state of one subsystem and the other subsystem. Those are the entangled states, of course, right? And so any idea of decomposition into systems and probability flows, all of this must work together. And we now think we made good progress. And one thing we haven't done yet, and that's, of course, the most difficult thing, we would like to formulate the measurement axioms as they are in quantum mechanics, as you postulate them. They're a little mysterious, to say the least.
Uh-huh.
But most of all, they contain a lot of talk. You say you conduct a measurement. For that, you have a Hermitian operator. Let's talk finite dimensions, otherwise self-adjoint operator. Okay, sure. Let's think finite dimensions. Quantum information technology justifies us in doing that, right? You have a Hermitian operator, and then you find the eigenvalues, and of course you can then calculate from the spectral decomposition, you can calculate the probability with which a certain measurement will occur if you measure now. But what do you mean will occur and if you measure now? And what does this all mean? It's just talk. It's talk that works spectacularly well, as we know, right? Quantum mechanics, in a sense, it works spectacularly well. But much of this talk, especially around measurement, is not at all reflected in the formalism. And of course, many people have worked on that. Many very smart people have worked on that, trying to explain measurement, the idea that decoherence may play a role. I guess it does. But is that the whole answer to the measurement problem? No, it is not. You know, all of these things. But this, what we're trying to do, is very modest, but maybe therefore it can be successful. We try to give an extended formalism, not deviating from quantum mechanics, but capturing much of the talk as much as we can in a formalism. And this idea of ports, but now not energy ports, but probability ports, play a big role. So it's a natural idea. Everybody can have it. We worked for a long time to really get this onto the street, because there are many little things you can trip over. And now I think we made some good progress. And once we're convinced, we went to a point that it's worth putting it out so that other people can start thinking about too, if they like. You'll hear from it. That's it. So, but that's what I'm thinking about quantum mechanics. And it's a very thorny issue because, you know, I mean, And it's also very easy to talk about the measurement problem because, it has been talked a lot about. It is a little bit quite dramatically a problem, right? I mean, Roger Penrose talks about it, of course, too. That's not a secret, so to speak. And we try to have a modest new approach to it. But the claim to fame, well, not fame, but you know what I mean, right? The reason why I think it might be useful, it uses a new technique and a new formalism with a purpose. So that's what I'm thinking about on that side.
Okay, so earlier you said that undergrads, well, you didn't use the word undergrad, but undergrads are taught about kinetic and potential and how you can flow between them as long as energy is conserved. But then you said it was all talk. What do you mean that it's all talk and not reflected in the formalism? And also port, because people keep hearing this word port. Port is spelled P-O-R-T and refers to the boundary ports.
Yes, the boundary ports, the other ports. It's very easily explained if we write it down. We can't do that right now. They're simple examples. Well, the point is, what is not reflected is you have a total energy that's conserved, and of course you can define a potential and a kinetic energy, and you say it flows between them because the sum of them is preserved, right? So, I'm not saying it's wrong talk. What I mean by it's only talk is it built into the formalism that you make use of that insight? Now, you're just saying you're looking at two observables, kinetic and potential energy. And they change their values as your system evolves, classically. You can, in a sense, monitor that classically. But as I said, we're not making use of that in any way. And then the question is really the kinetic energy, does that constitute a conceptual subsystem from which something flows elsewhere? You know, this all sounds good. I think there's also in some videos that you talk about where the mathematics, one confuses what physically happens with the mathematics and so on. It's of this type. I think it's really, I could now try to explain in words what a port is, and it would sound very fancy with dual variables and the application to each other gives then the measurable quantity, but it's really much better to actually write this down. Maybe I could write a small document after the podcast.
That would be great. I think people would love that. Note, I'll be placing these notes from this podcast in my Substack, which you can get by searching my name and the word Substack, or by visiting curtjaimungal.com, CurtJaimungal.com. I know it's a mouthful.
Yeah. But this is not my idea. So this has been done quite a while ago. It's just, I think it deserves, let me state it like this, it deserves some attention from theoretical physicists as well for application maybe in fundamental physics. We should at least think about whether this could help us with things we do. No? So that's the.
There are a couple of questions here that I have. So you said the phrase, it's a modest proposal, therefore it could be successful. Now, that's interesting. Not, it's a modest proposal and it could be successful. It's a modest proposal, therefore it could be successful. So I'm a stickler for words and I noticed that.
Yes.
Please tell me, what did you mean by that? Why is the modesty connected to the success?
Okay, at least for my means, I always think if I have one idea about something, like a measurement problem or something else, one idea, you know, ideas are cheap in our field. We can have many, many ideas, right? And we can then find the fifth and the sixth idea. And if we take these 10 ideas together, I believe trying to bring one idea to success works because you have this one idea, and then this idea, if it's any good, will lead you, if you try to implement it, will lead you to more insights, and then the problem dictates you what your next idea would have to be, something like that. Okay. Look, this is a philosophical subject, right? So I claim no truth to this, of course, but if you asked, I don't know, you could view, say, the whole development up to general relativity starting from Maxwell theory, that Einstein stared at the Maxwell equations, and the longer he stared and the more he thought about it, he realized there is something at odds with the idea of you know, the speed of light being in there. I mean, the C constant by, what is it, epsilon times mu is in there. How can that be in that equation? Because if you go to a moving system, shouldn't it be C plus V, where V is, mm-hmm. V is the moving system, right? So Einstein looked at Maxwell theory. In a sense, you can say Einstein took Maxwell theory very seriously. Okay? And taking Maxwell theory very seriously, he was prompted to change the idea of space and time, or even the separate existence of something like space and something of time. There's only space-time. Then there's no... So it's a very simple idea. It's very modest to say there is a theory that tells you how electromagnetic signals. Now, Heinrich Hertz, I think 1888, he proved that you can actually transmit by electromagnetic waves. You can send signals in the lab and stuff like this. And I think Maxwell was something like 1850, 1860, something like this with his equations. In 88, this was demonstrated. So they predicted electromagnetic waves. They really exist and it works and so on. So in a sense, saying, well, that works, and then we have a radio, and the radio... So it's a modest idea to say, let's take Maxwell theory very, very seriously. And then it leads to special relativity, and then for the inclusion of gravity, by whatever way you want to take there, say the Einsteinian way, it leads to the curvature of space and time. And if you want to a prediction in that theory, in that view, to a prediction of the Big Bang. Right? So in a sense, it's a very modest idea seen through. You see through this idea that you say Maxwell theory is correct. Right? And so I think seeing through one idea can open doors. So that's what I mean by it's a modest idea. One can make many constructions and ideas and intuitions and so on. I always think we need to rely on nature giving us a hint.
Uh-huh.
Because theory space is infinite dimensional. And if you tip with your finger somewhere and you say, oh, the metric may be non-symmetric. Einstein did that, right? I mean, Einstein in his later years, he fanatically looked for the inclusion of Maxwell theory into the geometric framework of general relativity. And of course, we had Kaluza-Klein, all these nice things, all very nice. But ultimately, it doesn't work. So far, we think. Einstein didn't find it. And so once Einstein, let's take Einstein also as a counterexample in a sense, once he started thinking in this formal way and have an idea, we could include this here, that didn't work so much anymore, I think, because he didn't have nature on his side like he had before with Maxwell theory.
Yes.
I don't know whether I make myself clear, and obviously these are not, this is not wisdom to follow by as a strict rule. It's a little bit my guiding principle in doing research, for better or worse. Huh?
Hi everyone, hope you're enjoying today's episode. If you're hungry for deeper dives into physics, AI, consciousness, philosophy, along with my personal reflections, you'll find it all on my Substack. Subscribers get first access to new episodes, new posts as well, behind-the-scenes insights, and the chance to be a part of a thriving community of like-minded pilgrimers. By joining, you'll directly be supporting my work and helping keep these conversations at the cutting edge. So click the link on screen here, hit subscribe, and let's keep pushing the boundaries of knowledge together. Thank you and enjoy the show. Just so you know, if you're listening, it's curtjaimungal.org, curtjaimungal.org.